I'd like to call to order the May 6, 2008, meeting of the Planning and Zoning Commission for the City of Louisville and announce that a quorum is present. First item on, sorry, the second item on the agenda is to approve the minutes of the April 15, 2008 meeting. Do I have any comments, corrections, additions, a motion?
Make a motion to approve the minute.
A motion from Karen, the second from Bill. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. First item, third item on the agenda, sorry. Third item on the agenda is regular hearing plats. Item 3A is a preliminary plat of UNICLA Edition, a 9.05 acre tract zone light industrial located on the north side of FM 407 and on the east side of Archer Road. David.
Good evening. As you mentioned, this is a plat. We call it the UNICLA Edition. And just for reference purposes, and you should have this in your backup as well, we've got Moccasin Trail, Archer Way, FM 407, and there's a Sonic Drive-In here at the corner. Just very briefly, what's occurred at this site is that there's a common ownership amongst the there's a common ownership of the property within the plat. The owners have sold one of the lots, or one of the proposed lots, lot 1 block B, to a purchaser who wishes to build a auto service or auto repair business. In order to do that, he's going to have to come back with a final plat of lot 1 block B. But prior to doing the final plat, we have to approve the preliminary plat of the entire property, which sort of sets the stage for how the remainder of the property will be divided and developed. The city's thoroughfare plan shows Moccasin Trail as a collector street. Ultimately, Moccasin Trail is going to extend further to the east and intersect with the I-35 frontage road. It currently ends right here at this L-shaped intersection. The general development ordinance will require that when this property is platted, that the developer not only dedicate the right-of-way for that extension through the property, but also build or construct Moccasin Trail across the property. In a situation like this, where you've got multiple lots that will be, developed at different points in time and not all at the same time, our development ordinance also allows the developer to put money in escrow for the future extension or improvement of adjacent roads that are either substandard or, in this case, really don't exist at all but do show up on our thoroughfare plan. Because all of these lots will develop at different times, the ordinance will allow that escrow as opposed to actual physical construction. And the general development ordinance also prescribes that when you do that escrow, that the escrow get divided up evenly among all the lots or phases within the development based on acreage. So that way, everybody who buys a lot and develops pays their proportionate share, and they don't get caught with a disproportionate share or more money than what they ought to based on the area of land that they're developing. To make a long story short, when this lot was sold to the current owner, because of the type of financing that was involved in the sale, the sellers are not getting a large cash return for that sale. So in essence, are not going to have the money to put in escrow for the extension of Moccasin Trail based on the sole sale of this one lot. So what they are proposing to do is split the cost of Moccasin Trail up among the remaining lots minus Lot 1 Block B, and divide it in accordance with the acreage so that the remaining lots will all pay a portion of the cost of Moccasin Trail based on their acreage. The exception would be Lot 1, which has frontage on Archer Way and doesn't really have any physical connection to Moccasin Trail, would not be required to participate in that particular cost. Normally, staff is quite cautious about allowing development to not participate in these types of development costs, because oftentimes what happens is that you let the first few lots go and then the last lot ends up getting burdened with the entire cost of the improvements. But in this case, the owners, again, the sellers, have agreed to pay the entire cost of Moccasin Trail and have agreed to split it up across the four remaining lots, and with the one lot that's being accepted being one of the smaller lots out of the subdivision, staff does not feel that that should cause any undue burden to any of the other future lot owners. So staff is recommending approval of the plat and the variance. I'll be glad to answer any questions you may have. Also, we have some representatives here from the owners of the property, if you have any questions of them.
Anyone have any questions for David? David, when, so let me make sure I understand this. So the owner then puts, the current owner of the entire parent tract, which I assume is this entire piece of land, correct? This is all considered the parent tract?
Right. The parent tract is just over 9 acres.
And it's everything below Moccasin and above?
Correct, with the exception of the little corner where the Sonic is.
Okay. So the current owner is going to put all the money in escrow, and then they'll recoup that cost when they actually sell off their lots. In other words, they'll have to get that from whoever they sell the lots to by considering that in their cost of selling.
I believe what the plan is that money will be placed in escrow as the remaining four lots develop.
Okay.
And so between those four lots, it should total the full amount. They're just taking the fifth lot, Lot 1 Block B, out of the equation and redistributing the total amount. Now, the one little caveat that we have here, which the owners have agreed to, is if Lot 1 Block C, which is just over 4 acres, develops ahead of any of these other lots, which are relatively small, south of Moccasin Trail, they'll agree, the owners or the sellers will agree to put up the full amount at that time, all at one time, rather than waiting for these smaller lots to develop. So that's even an added benefit to this particular variance.
How does that get recorded for the future?
Well, of course, it's recorded because it is a variance, and it ultimately has to be approved by the City Council. Also, the variance is actually listed on the plat document if it's approved.
The escrow is listed?
Yeah, the actual, when we do the final, first of all, with the preliminary plat, the variance is listed on the plat. And we already have an engineered estimate with regard to the cost of the roads, so we know how to divide it up. Then when these individual lots come in with final plats, that escrow amount will be listed on the final plat as well as the engineering site plan, which will be required because they're commercial.
David, one clarification point It states that the owner wishes to relocate an existing automotive repair business. Is that in the area, the immediate area?
Yes, I believe the existing business is on Highway 407, further to the west. And they're proposing to build a larger building, and I think where they're at currently, they're leasing the space, and they're actually want to own and construct their own building.
Okay, so they currently reside in that area anyway?
Correct, yeah, they're in this area, so they're not moving very far.
Okay, thank you.
David, so this is the, our attorneys look over these kind of things, right? And vet this out and make sure that this is, you know, 20 years from now, somebody's not going, what were they thinking?
Well, as a matter of fact, in this particular case, I did run this variance through our attorney's office. And, in fact, they recommended that we, you know, work out the variance based on this proposal, that they felt it was a reasonable solution.
David, I'm sorry, I'm going to come back to this because for some reason I still just don't have in my head exactly how this works. One, there is one owner of this entire lot right now, including Block B.
Correct.
They have plans to develop all of to develop and or sell all of these lots.
The owners of the parent tract, I do not believe, have any intention of developing the property. They simply want to sell it, divide it into lots, and sell it.
So I'm back to my original question. When they sell the lots, whoever buys that lot and plats it has to put the money in escrow for their portion.
Well, and that'll be between the seller and the buyer.
Right.
But the seller has committed to placing money in escrow before the final plats are actually approved.
Okay, for each lot that they...
For each lot. So okay. As each lot is sold and then ultimately platted, then before the plat can be approved, the escrow amount specific to that lot will have to be placed in escrow with the city before the plat even gets before the planning and zoning
commission. Though the owner has then sold the lot, and the person, the corporation or person, whoever, who buys the lot has to go through the platting process, the parent owner is going to come back and pay the escrow on behalf of the developing owner?
And there again, that'll be a contractual arrangement between them and the buyer and the seller. I mean, the seller may very well choose to put the money up from the proceeds into the escrow account, but that's up to them how they want to fund that. But okay. Ultimately, you can't approve a plat, and in turn, staff wouldn't be able to approve any site plans unless that escrow money was already in a city account.
Okay.
Regardless of who it comes from.
All right. Any other questions? Or David, or the developer, or owner?
No.
I don't think so. So, this is a regular hearing, I believe. So, do we have any other conversation from any of the commission members before we ask for a a motion? And I'll entertain a motion if there's no conversation on this.
I'd like to make a motion that item 3A be approved as presented.
Second.
I have a motion from Jim and a second from Karen on item 3A to recommend approval of the preliminary plat to City Council. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries for item 3A. Item 4 on the agenda is the public hearing zoning, and we have 4 for consideration tonight. So we will take these one by one. Item 4A is consideration of a zone change request from Old Town Mixed Use 2, an office district, to public use on a 2.25 acre tract located at 201 West Main Street. The request is being made by the City of Louisville, the current property owner. This is case number PZ 2008-0512.
All right, this is a zone change request from Office District and Old Town Mixed Use 2 to public use. This is actually 7 pieces of property, and one of them is Old Town Mixed Use 2, which is this piece here. The rest of it is zoned Office District. This used to be the Temple Baptist Church property that the city has purchased, demolished, and has the plans to put in the city arts facility. Other properties in the block are zoned Office District and Old Town Mixed Use 2, and the properties in the surrounding block are really just a variety of uses and zoning from Old Town Mixed Use 2, Old Town Mixed Use 1, single-family residential, Office District, and general business in Old Town Center, so you have a wide variety surrounding this property. Again, the property is currently vacant lot planned for the City Cultural Arts and Activity Center. The proposed zoning classification public use is in compliance with the Old Town Master Plan. The city is requesting the zone change to be in compliance with the master plan. Since it is in compliance with the master plan, staff is recommending that the Planning and Zoning Commission recommend approval of the proposed zone change request. And it's pretty straightforward, I think. If you have any questions, I'm here for you. So,
thank you, Sarah. Do we have any questions, comments, discussion from the commission? If not, I will entertain a motion on item 4A, please.
Open the
public hearing. Sorry. My apologies. I will open the public hearing on item 3A. Anyone wishing to speak for or against item 3A, please step forward. Is that what I said? I'm getting a correction from my right. Item 4A is open to the public hearing. If there is no one, I'll entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Bill and a second by Karen. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 The public hearing is closed. Any discussion on 4A before we now ask for a motion?
Make a motion to approve item 4A as presented.
Second.
Motion from Karen, second from Jim, to approve item 4A for recommendation to City Council. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, item 4A carries. Item 4B on the agenda is consideration of a zone change request from General Business to Old Town Center on a 0.15-acre tract located at 136 and 138 West Main Street, further identified as tracts 120 and 121 of the J.W. King Survey, abstract 696. The request is being made by 13 Fevers, LLC, the current property owner. This is case number PZ 2008-0513.
In case you have trouble seeing the outline, it's right here. It's actually two parcels, and this is currently zoned general business, and the proposed zone change request is to Old Town Center business. And this will be the first property in the block to zone in compliance with the Old Town Master Plan, and it will be the first property in the block to zone Old Town Center. Again, all of the properties in the block are general business, and the proposed zoning classification Old Town Center business is in compliance with the recommendations of the master plan. The applicant wishes to rezone just to take the opportunity to become in compliance with the master plan, and because the setbacks are more flexible for Old Town Center than they are for general business. The general business zoning allows setbacks the front for 25 feet, side 10 to 15 feet and rear 0 to 25 feet, whereas Old Town Center requires that the front facade be set at the property line, does not have requirements for the side setback nor for the rear. Because the proposed zoning Old Town Center is in compliance with the Old Town Master Plan, again, staff's recommendation is that the Planning and Zoning Commission recommend approval of the item. I'm here for any questions that you may have about this.
Thank you again, Sarah. Does anyone have any questions, comment, discussion on 4B? Mm-hmm. Okay, I will open the public hearing on item 4B. Anyone wishing to speak for or against this item on the agenda, please step forward now. I believe we have no one. Do I have a motion to close the public hearing?
Make a motion to close the public hearing.
Second.
Motion from Karen. Second from Bill to close the public hearing. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Public hearing is closed on item 4B. Any other discussion by the commission? Do I have a motion?
Make a motion to approve item 4B as presented.
Second.
A motion from Karen, second from James to approve item 4B. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries on item 4B. Next item on the agenda is item 4C, consideration of a zone change request from light industrial to Old Town Mixed Use 2 on a 0.31 acre tract located at 115 Leonard Street, further identified as lots 7 and 8, block 14, Keeley Edition. The request is being made by Garvey Holmes, the current property owner. This is case number PZ 2008-0515.
Okay. This is a proposal to change the zoning from light industrial to Old Town Mixed Use 2. There's one other property on this block that is zoned Old Town Mixed Use 2, with the other properties still remaining light industrial. Properties in the surrounding blocks are mostly zoned Old Town Mixed Use 2 and light industrial, with one property zoned multifamily 1. The property is currently a single-family home with some residential storage buildings. The plan is for the property owner to demolish those buildings and build an office building on that property. And the owner would like to rezone for better setbacks on the property for his office building. The setbacks for LI are 25 feet for the front, 10 to 15 feet for the rear, and 0 to 50 feet. I'm sorry, 10 to 15 feet for the side and 0 to 15 feet for the rear, whereas in Old Town Mixed Use 2, there is no front setback. The side setback for commercial is 0, and the rear setback for commercial is 10 feet. So this is in his interest to do that, as well as in compliance with the Old Town Master Plan. Again, since this is another proposal that's in compliance with the Old Town Master Plan, staff is in support of this and does recommend that the Planning and Zoning Commission recommend approval of the item. If you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them for you.
Excuse me. Do we have any questions for Sarah? Okay, thank you, Sarah. And I will now open the public hearing on item 4C. Anyone wishing to speak for or against item 4C, please step forward. If not, could I have a motion, please, to close the public hearing?
Make a motion to close the public hearing.
Second.
Motion from Karen, second from Jim to close the public hearing on item 4C. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? The public hearing is closed on item 4C. Any further discussion or a motion, please, on 4C?
Make a motion to approve item 4C as presented.
Have a motion from Karen. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second from Alvin. Motion from Karen and the second from Alvin on item 4C, recommending approval to City Council. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Item 4D on the agenda, consideration of a zone change request from light industrial to mixed use 90 on a 90.08 acre tract located north of State Highway 121, west of the railroad tracks, south of Lakeside Circle and east of Timber Creek, further identified as McKinney and Williams Survey, Abstract 936, Tract 3A, A.J. Hitchcock Survey, Abstract 614, Tracks 2, 2A, 3, BBB and CRR CO Survey, Abstract 144, Tracks 1A, 9. The request is being made by Riverside DPH LP, the current property owner. This is case number PZ 2008-0514.
The memo that we sent with the packet, we tried to lay out the issues and the zoning questions on this one. It's our first mixed-use 90, MU 90 zoning, which was created a short time back to allow a little more flexibility for some infill development. If you have at least 90 acres, we have a mixed-use 90, we have a mixed-use 30, and a mixed-use shopping center. Intended primarily to help older shopping centers find a way to fill up some of their space. But this is our first MU90, and we don't know how many other MU90s we'll get, so we sort of played earn while you learn with this one. In the end, the bottom question will still be, as with any zoning request, is this the highest and best use of this piece of property? But because of the mixed-use 90 requirements, the applicant is required to show exactly what they want to build on the property. Staff has been working with them diligently for more than 6 months, I think, to come up with a product and to come up with a layout that gives them what they're looking for and shows us enough information to get an idea of what they're actually proposing to build. The development, the request is what you see on the overhead on the on your screen, is for that particular piece of property, but the entire area that is owned and controlled by both the city of Louisville and Huffines communities is really in discussion, but the zoning is only for this part. You received a memo from Nika Reinicke to give you some background on how this fits into the overall development. Something else for you to consider when you're considering your recommendation on the zoning request, but this is the only piece that's actually up for zoning at this time. If this goes through and is approved, there will be rezoning on some of the property on the east side of this for the future development. This particular request is for consideration of 1,726 apartments and 20,000 square feet of office and retail space. It's primarily a site that is benefiting from the location of the proposed DCTA South Louisville train station, which will be in this location here along Lakeside Circle. There's a where the GB is an existing power substation. The rest of that property in this area up to the roadway is zoned multifamily, but it's been zoned multifamily that way a long time, and really we've had no interest from anyone wanting to build on it because of the substation. Nobody wants to really have apartments right next to an electric substation out of concerns for possible health hazards. And the DCTA, in looking at it, decided that would be a very good location for a future train station. And one of the things you look for when you have a train station is density. So there are three other apartment complexes on Lakeside Circle and other apartment complexes nearby north of Hebron Parkway. And having apartments at this location would add to the density. And that's really the best thing about this project, is adding more density to the train station location. There are five variances being requested in conjunction with this zoning request. One is to utilize a smaller street section, which is allowed for Old Town streets. And the second is to allow the head-end parking in the right-of-way, which in effect would be off-site parking for their parking count. Staff feels that in both of these cases, because this is not doesn't have a major thoroughfare running through it, and traffic counts will not be heavy, and so neither of these issues really pose what we consider a significant problem. The third variance is to go with 1.65 parking spaces per dwelling unit rather than the two required in the ordinance, but a very high percentage, 75% to 80%, they have the exact number of the units, or one-bedroom units. And the council has recently granted a variance to another apartment complex for a reduction in their parking count because of the high percentage of one-bedroom units. So we really don't have a problem with that one. The fourth variance is to allow the future rail crossing. They're proposing a rail crossing in the future down in this area here. And that rail crossing would be a later phase, but the ordinance would require the rail crossing to be above the 100-year floodplain. Well, the rail itself is in the 25-year floodplain, and it's not going to be raised. So it's a technical variance that the staff would have no problem with, because it doesn't make sense to require them to build a higher crossing when the rail itself is not going to be any higher. The final variance is to allow two dead-end streets to exceed the 600-foot maximum on your... on your layouts. Streets would come from here down to here and then over and down to here. This piece of property here, if everything works out, will become city property. So in effect, those streets will dead end onto city property and will be connected through an access easement here. So again, this is a technical variance where they are dead end streets, but they're not strictly dead end because there will be connection between them. And the Fire Marshal's Office did not have a problem with it as proposed. Having a relatively upscale, high-density development near the South Louisville train station is definitely a plus from a transportation standpoint. The other three apartment complexes along Lakeside Circle add to that. The 20,000 square feet of commercial, which will be primarily in this area here, that would fit in well with the density for the apartments in the area, as well as provide services for people going to the train station looking for a newspaper, a cup of coffee, and dropping off dry cleaning and that kind of thing. There is the potential in the future, and it's not included with this zoning request, but they are designing it so that in the future they could come along with these units that face their amenity center in the middle and convert those to retail and office if there's determined in the future to be a market for it. So they're building it now and including the zoning for that to be apartments, but they're at least putting us on notice that if in the future the market is sufficient, they will come back through the process, and it will require going back through the process to request a change on some or all of that to be office or retail if there's a market for it. So if the zoning is approved, this project actually fits very well into this area, primarily because of the train station. The ultimate question, though, is still whether the use is the highest and best use of the property. The trend has been for discouraging giving up light industrial in favor of residential of any kind, particularly apartments. So staff in our recommendation is recommending that you consider. We're not recommending approval. We're not recommending denial. The project meets the intent of the MU90 district and would be well suited to the neighborhood with the other apartments and the train station. We aren't recommending approval because the request is giving up developable light industrial land for a primarily high-density residential use, and the council has twice denied variances recently to allow stucco in apartments. These, as you've seen in the brochures they provided, do not meet the 80% brick requirement, but in the MU90, that is not a requirement. But it is something for you to take into consideration when you're weighing out whether to recommend approval or denial of this request. So we think overall it's a very good proposal as far as what they're proposing. The real question is, this a suitable location for 1,726 apartments and 20,000 square feet of office and retail space? The applicant is here and will have a presentation, but I'm available for questions.
I have a question. On the picture you had up there, where's the commercial?
On this picture, the commercial is this building here, which is just south of the train station. This is the train station parking lot here. This is the power substation. So that would be where people could pull into the parking lot, walk over here for their coffee or newspaper or whatever, and walk back. And it would serve these apartments and conceivably the other apartments in the neighborhood.
Is there an entrance on the north end of it? Or is it just the one entrance over the creek?
There's an entrance in this location here.
Can't see that thing.
Primary entrance will be in this location off of Lakeside Circle. There will be, until this bridge is built, there will be another entrance up here so that it complies with the requirements of the fire marshal's office. But they do have, on this property here, there is a contract where this owner has provided land for them to be able to build the road from the I-35 service road and build the bridge to get to this piece of property. So it will still have to, in spite of everything else, it will still have to comply with all the other applicable development standards in our general development ordinance.
What middle school handles this area for the school system?
I have no idea.
Timber Creek? Okay.
Typically, if 75% to 80% are one-bedroom apartments, the school district has indicated that that does not generally produce very many kids for the school system.
James, so who lives in a place like that?
Who what?
Single people? Single people live in a place like that?
Single people and empty nesters. People who are looking for location close to shopping, close to restaurants, close to a train stop, but they don't want to have to mess with the yard and all those things. They can drive a car if they want to, but they don't have to, because things are either within walking distance or within short distance to the train.
Do we have any other questions or comments for Gene?
No.
From anyone?
So why the stucco? Why so much stucco?
The architects who designed the three types of buildings that they're proposing, there's stucco, there's glazing, there's wood and other things, so it's not just pure stucco. Those particular buildings, two of the three styles, I believe, have been built in the Woodlands near Houston, and that's just a style that a lot of people feel fits into that kind of environment. So it is a very high quality exterior finish. It's just that our regulations require the 80% brick, but they feel like and they can tell you more of this. They're thinking on it, but they've indicated to us they feel like this particular style fits in with the look and feel that they're trying to achieve for this area. Rather than just having brick apartments that look like all the other brick apartments.
What's the timing on building the bridge across there?
I'll let them give you more specifics on it, but as I understand, they would propose to start the bridge fairly early in the project. The first phase, the bridge wouldn't be ready, but I think by the second phase, they would try to have the bridge in and complete.
Okay. I'll save my question for them then.
Okay. There's also a water line associated with the bridge that they need to have in so that the bridge will be fairly early in the process so they won't have adequate water.
Any other questions from my left over here? Anything from my right over here? Calvin, maybe? Okay. Thank you, Gene. At this time, I guess we will open the public hearing for item 4D on the agenda. And I understand we have the developer here for a presentation, and anyone else also who wants to speak for or against this after that is welcome to do so. You could step forward, and do we have a sign-in, Gene, up there? Do we have a sign-in up there for him?
Yes, we do.
Sign in, and then state your, your name.
Good evening. I'm Donald Huffines, co-owner of Huffines Communities. I'm very excited to be here tonight to present to y'all the Hebron 121 station. It's something Louisville hasn't had, and it's something we're very excited about. We've been working with the City Council now for on and off for 3 years on this project, and with staff 2 years or so. And we feel like this is a great location, and the best location in the Metroplex for this type of multifamily community. I'm going to introduce Howard Porteous. He's our project manager on this community, and he's going to give you the full presentation on it. We also assembled a great team for it. The civil engineer is here tonight and is our apartment partner here. So they can answer all your questions about the community as I can. Howard, you want to come up?
As Donald mentioned, my name is Howard Porteous. I'm the project manager for this project. I've been working with staff on and off for about a year now, and trying to come up with an appropriate layout and plan to bring this project forward. With the implementation of the new mixed-use zoning, it provided us the opportunity to create a project which had its own neighborhood-type commercial within it that would service the needs and the uses that a community apartment would have. It also, we designed this project with, as Gene touched upon, the flexible space on the first floors. Those will be designed and built that way up front with the intention that if the market is driven, an entire building obviously would not intermix apartments with commercial. The parking design is also created ahead of time to support that. So it would be our intent, if the market dictates, to be able to add additional commercial and make this a very nice village green. As with the history of Huffines Communities, we have many successful communities in the area, Waterview, Savannah, Providence, that are on this northerly end. The central theme is to create a centralized amenity package which supports the community and draws everybody to the center. As you can see in our design, bear with me. This, by the way, the picture that's up right now is a picture of the proposed boardwalk. It's intended to, adjacent to the bridge on both sides going up and down the lake, to have a usable boardwalk that would tie into the project. And also, as Gene mentioned, the road that crossed 35 to this project is currently under design, and have been working with the city on the design of that, and the bridge would be done with the first phase. It is our intention to bring that on immediately. As I mentioned, this center section here would be our amenity center. It would have a front lawn private area. It would have a 12,000-foot clubhouse, a resort-style pool with a lazy river. It would also have a pedestrian walkway that would cross over the center of the entire complex. On the other end, it would have a small amphitheater for on the weekends and evenings to provide small concerts, possibly even outdoor movies. And then it would also have a covered pavilion, which would be a covered sport court with basketball courts and other interior uses. That center courtyard around the outside would be a one-way street going counterclockwise. We'd enter in from Cross 35 or from the lakeside access. The parking, as we tried to do, is kind of emulates the old town here in Louisville, which we actually like a lot. We like that look and that feel. We think it creates a very nice sense of community. There is a third access that would go out across the railroad tracks and ultimately interconnect where the new proposed railroad street is, and that's right here on the side is that crossing. And that also conjoins with some additional uses that, as part of this whole master plan, within your book, it shows a colored map with red and green, that there's some additional commercial that's available to develop at a later time along Hebron and directly adjacent to that. And at this point, we used Humphreys and Partners as our architect. They're a local Dallas firm. We used Graham Engineering out of Arlington. And you know, we felt we would go with local and successful. Humphreys designs and has built of their product about 50,000 units a year nationwide. And obviously, Graham has designed such things as the new Ball Stadium in Arlington, and they just designed another project for us in Arlington as well. And I'm ready if you have any questions, or we can ask questions of our engineers or architects, whatever we can do to answer a few things for you.
Thank you, Mr. Fortes. I'm sure somebody probably has some questions, comments.
I have one. Is any part of this in the floodplain?
The reclamation, if you've been out to the project in recent times, we did have a 404 permit and all of the appropriate permits and have reclaimed this property. It's about 85% completed. I would estimate by the 15th of June, the reclamation will be totally done and mitigation trees back in and revegetated, and there will be none of it in the floodplain.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Any other questions? Jim, Karen, anybody? Okay.
Thank you very much. I appreciate your time.
The public hearing is still open, so anyone wishing to speak for or against this item or give some information on it is welcome to come forward. If not, do I have a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
Motion from Bill and a second from James to close the public hearing. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 All those opposed? Public hearing is closed. Do we have any discussion on this rather large venture? Any likes? Any dislikes?
I was prepared not to like it. I like it a lot right now. I've completely.
Other than not being thrilled about the stucco.
Well, I mean, I just wondered about the stucco. I didn't have anything against stucco. Pardon me? No, no. I just, you know, I like the idea. I mean, I'm just seeing the gas prices going up. I'm seeing this rail station happening. I'm seeing people getting more cognizant that it's never going to go down again like it has
so
in years past.
You don't want to have to be where you always have to drive around.
And
everywhere.
So, I mean, I think there'll be people that are interested in this kind of community. I spent all, well, 2 weeks ago down at downtown Dallas at the Hyatt Regency, and everybody was coming in and out on the Dallas rail. And I just, you know, it was so cool, so urban and everything. I mean, I'd love for this to be this way, for those people who want that. And I think, you know, there's quite a few people. So.
Right.
I didn't want to like it. I tried not to like it.
I think it's an excellent idea. We go through South Lake and Frisco and many of the other municipalities, and they're cookie cutters. All the buildings look the same. And this is a change. I think it's a gateway into Lewisville because it has intersection of two major thoroughfares, and I think it's going to be a good example of what can be done. You all already commented on it.
Thank you, Bill. Anyone else want to make any comments? Karen? You can tell your busting to say something.
I have one question, mainly probably aimed at Gene. With the expansion of 35,
How much of the front property, where the grass company used to be, is going to be taken away?
The state will be building a ramp from the westbound elevated portion of 121 to connect to northbound I-35. And right now, if you want to go northbound, you have to exit, stop at the service road and turn right and go down. Well, they'll be eliminating that and the one on the other side. That will cause, at the turn itself, a good amount of land to be taken, although the property south of this, where the road is coming up, where the agreement with the property owner to bring that road up, they'll be losing some of their property, some of their frontage, but they still have a goodly amount left to develop and in fact are talking to us now about developing that particular piece of property.
Thank you.
Just a couple comments. Congratulations to staff for a very thorough presentation and analysis of what we're looking at, something that we've not seen very much of in the past. I, for one, work downtown Dallas in One Arts Plaza and parts of the Arts District, and this gives me the feel of Victory Park, as you were downtown, Joy. You see things like West Village downtown, very similar type of concept, and it's busy all the time. There's a lot of residents in the area. This looks like something you find in Las Colinas. And frankly, I think it's, compliments to the developer for bringing something like this to Lewisville. It's about time. I would rather us see something like this, very progressive and urban appearance, rather than continuous multi-storage buildings. We've got our share of the light industrial look. I think it's an excellent use of the property, of the land. Thank you.
Anybody else? Well, then I will wrap it up by saying I think it's a wonderful idea, too, and I appreciate Huffines for coming out and presenting this to us, and I appreciate the staff also. It sounds like, a lot of times we don't realize, Mr. Huffines and Mr. Porteous, that you said you've been working for anywhere from 1 to 3 years with the city on this. So, we get these packets and we think that all this stuff gets thrown together overnight. And in fact, it doesn't. It takes a long time and a lot of thought and a lot of debate and discussion. So I think it's a great idea. I think it, to me, the other places that it reminds me of are the Legacy Town Center in Plano. It reminds me of the Austin Ranch over on the edge of the Colony in Plano. I think the advantage we have is we're going to have a rail station going through it, which they don't have. So even the people who live in those areas still pretty much have to hop on the toll road. They have to, get in their car and head out if they want to go anywhere. So I think this brings that, plus the advantage of the rail. So I think it's really great. I've always loved sort of the urban. I don't know if I'll ever live in one like this, but I've always loved them in traveling sometimes and seeing cities that are older, that have the subway systems and things, that have these communities that do sort of revolve around that. And I think it's a great idea because it brings people, it brings a sense of that sense of urban, and I think it brings people into that community who want to sort of be a part of their little community there. And you see people out, like you said, all the time, and they're active. Whereas you get around some of our residential neighborhoods, even mine, and yeah, we have people maybe rollerblading a little bit or walking their dogs, but nothing really like this. So I think it's a nice change of pace for the city. And again, I think with some of this coming as the infill, as we're looking at a lot of this being infill and not really, really enormous tracts of land, you have to think of things that are creative. And, we have the rail coming through, and it gives us a chance for something really creative that others don't have a chance to do. So I think it's really a great idea, too, and I appreciate everyone who's done all their homework on it, and the developer and owner and everyone. So with that, before Karen points at me down there, I will entertain a motion. Oh, did I already close the public hearing, Karen? Are you keeping track for me?
No.
Okay, I will entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
Oh, you've already done that.
Oh, thank you, Karen. Okay, I've closed the public hearing. Do we have any final comments from anyone? I think this is really great, and again, I appreciate everything that everyone's presented tonight. Do we have a motion?
I'd like to make a motion to approve item 4D as presented.
Second.
Have a motion from Jim and a second from Joy. This is for item 4D on the agenda. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed?
Aye.
We have one opposed vote from Karen. And Karen, would you like to make any statement for the record at all, or leave it as an opposed vote? Okay. Thank you, Karen. So we have a 6-1 vote on item 4D. Item 5 on the agenda is other business. We have one that's listed here, consider an alternate planning and zoning date for dates for November 2008 due to schedule conflict with the federal elections. Gene?
The normal dates for November would be Tuesday the 4th and Tuesday the 18th, but the 4th will be the day in which elections are held. State and federal elections, and I don't think it'll be quite as hectic as some of the primary voting that we had here, but after talking with the city secretary, we're going to recommend that you perhaps have just one meeting in November and just do it on the 18th and not have one on the 4th so that you can all stay at home and watch the election results as they come in from across state and nation.
Wouldn't miss it on a bit.
So if you all do not object to that, then when we set up our calendar, we will leave off a meeting for November 4th, but we'll just have one meeting on the 18th unless there is objection.
Plus, we may be watching the election results, what, the next day and the next? And the next, maybe?
Not this time.
Okay, so do you just want sort of a consensus from everyone here? Because I doubt anyone has a problem with that.
Yeah. It's not really set up to take a vote on, but
right.
we're telling you that that's what we're planning on doing unless you all have an objection to that.
I don't believe so.
It's
a good idea. Good move. So do we have any other business from staff? Anyone? No other business. I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Motion from Karen and a second from Alvin to adjourn. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.